we are here constituted as one leaders of the 1st July movement, myself as the spokesperson, and Honorable Jacob Ngarafumwe as the convener. Secondly, we are also here as ex-H Group Maximum Prison Political Detainees Association, of those people who have been incarcerated and have been at group maximum prison for their political views. If Morgan Tsvangirai was alive today, he could have been the patron of that organization. Even if Davengwa or Lucas Masop was alive today, they were going to be members of the ex group maximum prison political detainees association. So we are here also to express our personal views concerning the current persecution of citizens of our country who hold a different political views to the current regime. I think, as you all understand, one of us who was with us at Chikurit Maximum Prison for over a period of 40 days of recent past, Hopewell Chingono was arrested yesterday. I've had an opportunity to converse with his legal practitioners, and we are told that he is being charged for contravening section 182 A or B of the code. That is the Criminal Law Codification and Reform Act, specifically saying that he is charged of contempt of court. That in one of his tweets, as a journalist, he was in contempt of the court. Why I am saying this charge to you is that we want you to be very clear. He is not being charged for undermining the judiciary, but he is alleged to have been contempt of court. Contempt of court is a criminal offense where somebody is accused of having undermined a judicial officer who would be either presiding over your case or somebody who has a direct interest in your matter. So the facts to the case as obtained from the brief that we obtained is that the tweet was talking about his insinuation that the Chief Justice is interfering with the judiciary in our country. And what really surprised and shocked the majority of us is that the judiciary is one of the institutions of the state. And we all understand that the state is made up of three arms of government. One being the executive, the second one being the legislature, and the third one being the judiciary. The judiciary is prone to scrutiny by both practitioners of law and also by citizens on the basis that it is one of those arms of government that is financed through public funding, and also it is one of the most critical sectors of our society as it services the public. So we are outraged and also shocked with the way how the current government has weaponized the law to fight against those people who are calling it to be accountable to the citizens of this country. There is no offense at all for somebody to bring out his or her own views concerning either of the three arms of the state on the basis that there is a jurisprudence at law that citizens are allowed to hold views about their judiciary to avoid what is called the tyranny of the judiciary, where the judiciary becomes sacrosanct and not prone to scrutiny by either citizens or other arms of government. So we are shocked, and we are in a state of shock that the government would arrest Opuya Chingono on the basis of his views, which he has expressed on the standing of the judiciary at the present moment. Furthermore, I want to add to you, members of the Fourth Estate, that you are members who should be allowed to be practitioners of your profession without interference from the government. Throughout the world, except in authoritarian and tyrannical regimes, would members of the Fourth Estate not be allowed to exercise their profession by bringing out to the citizens what they are meeting on a daily basis? Zimbabwe is one of the countries in the world at the present moment with a very sad record of persecuting members of the press. Opuya Chingono is a member of the press. He is the member of the Fourth Estate. We are expecting every legitimate authority to respect his duty to carry out his profession as determined by the ethics of the profession. So we are scared that if members of the Fourth Estate are now arrested for bringing out their own personal views, this country is going down the drain. So we are here to express our shock and outrage over the weaponization of the law to fight those people who are holding contrary views, who are asking the government to be accountable to the citizens of this country. And it is not criminal for people to hold different views from those that are being held by the government. This is a man who recently was in prison for 45 days. Now he hasn't yet completed 45 days outside the prison. He has expressed himself as a citizen. Again, the state have used the law as a weapon to silence critics of their behavior in our country. So we are in total solidarity with our colleague. We are with him. We are going to stand with him, tooth, nail, and claw, in the persecution he is currently facing before the regime. He is one man whom I shared the same prison cells with at Chikrubi Maximum Prison. He has immeasurable love for this country. He has no any political ambition. He has no any other issue that he needs but to take government accountable for each and every action that take place in our country. We don't expect a society where civil liberties and civil rights in our country become victim of a government that does not accept itself to be criticized. Fundamental human rights are the cornerstone of every democratic society. Zimbabwe cannot continue on the path of dictatorship and authoritarianism, the way how things are being run in our country at the present moment. We have come here to tell you that we are asking even the international community, the regional members of our state, that there is truly a crisis in our country. A crisis of persecuting those people who hold contrary views to the current government. That there is unprecedented abduction, torture, and human rights abuses in our country. There is no country in Africa which is a crisis more than Zimbabwe. So we call upon SADC to make sure that this crisis in our country do not escalate into a full-fledged conflict. And we must all play our role as responsible citizens, that we are not going to see our country degenerating into a full-fledged conflict. We also call upon the United Nations in terms of Chapter 7 of the United Nations Charter, specifically Article 42 and 43, that allows the United Nations Security Council to pass resolutions concerning those states with a humanitarian crisis. Ours is a humanitarian crisis. It involves the breach of international crimes such as abduction, torture, and crimes against humanity. The United Nations must be able to exercise, the United Nations Security Council must be able to exercise its powers as provided for in Chapter 7, Article 42 and 43, to sit down and pass a resolution that the crisis in Zimbabwe cannot be continued to escalate the way it is escalating, because it is a threat to stability in our country that can spill over into the region. So the Security Council will call upon itself to quickly sit down and put Zimbabwe on its agenda and mitigate over issues of human rights abuses that have been taking place in our country, and that has reached unprecedented level. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.